Wi-Fi on all tired jades, on all mad musters, and all foul ways. Was ever man so beaten? Was ever man so rage? Was ever man so weary? I am sent before to make a fire, and they're coming after to warm them. Now, were I not a little pot and soon hot, my very lips might freeze to my teeth, my tongue to the roof of my mouth, my heart in my belly, ere I should come by a fire to thaw me. But I, with blowing the fire, shall warm myself. For considering the weather, a taller man than I will take cold. Hello! Ho, Curtis!
Who is that, coarse or coldly?
A piece of ice.
Oh.
If thou doubt it, thou mayst slide from my shoulder to my heel with no greater a run but my head and my neck. Have fire, good Curtis.
Is my master and his wife coming, Grumio?
Oh, aye, Curtis, aye, and therefore fire, fire, cast on no water.
Is she so hot a shrew as she's reported?
She was, good Curtis, before this frost. But thou knowest winter tames man, woman, and beast. For it hath tamed my old master and my new mistress and my fellow Curtis.
Away, you three-inch fool, I am no beast.
Am I but 3 inches? Why, thy horn is a foot, and so long am I at the least. But wilt thou make a fire? Or shall I complain of thee to our mistress, whose hand, she being now at hand, thou shalt soon feel to thy cold comfort for being slow in thy hot office?
I prithee, good Grumio, tell me, how goes the world?
A cold world, Curtis, in every office but thine, and therefore fire. Do thy duty and have thy duty, for my master and mistress are almost frozen to death.
There's fire ready, and therefore, good Grumio, the news.
Why, Jack boy, ho boy, and as much news as I wilt.
Come, you're so full of coney catching.
Why, therefore, fire, for I've caught extreme cold. Oh, where's the cook? Supper ready.
Aye.
The house trimmed.
Aye.
Rushes strewed.
Aye.
Cobwebs swept.
Aye.
The serving men in their new fustian.
Aye.
The white stockings.
Aye.
And every officer's wedding garment on.
Aye.
Be the jacks fair within and the jills fair without.
Aye.
The carpets laid and
aye.
Everything in order.
Aye, all ready. And therefore I pray thee news.
First now, my horse is tired, my master and mistress fallen out.
How?
Out of their saddles and into the dirt. And thereby hangs a tale.
Let's have it, good Grumio.
Lend thine ear.
Here.
There.
This is to feel a tale, not to hear a tale.
And therefore it is called a sensible tale. And this cuff was but a knock at your ear, beseech Leslie. Now I begin. In Primus, we came down a foul hill. My master riding behind my mistress.
Both of one horse?
What's that to thee?
Why, a horse.
Tell thou the tale.
Ah. Oh.
But hadst thou not crossed me, thou shouldst have heard how her horse fell, and she unto her horse. Thou shouldst have heard how she was bemoiled, how he left her with the horse upon her, how he beat me, how she waded through the dirt to pluck him off me, how he swore, how she prayed that never prayed before, how I cried, how the horses ran away, how her bridle was burst, how I lost my crupper, with many things of worthy memory which now shall die in oblivion. And thou returned unexperienced to thy grave.
By this reckoning, he is more shrew than she.
Aye, and that thou and the proudest of you all shall find when he comes home. But what talk I this? Call forth Nathaniel, Joseph, Nicholas, Philip, Walter, Sugarshop, and the rest. Let the heads be slickly combed, their blue coats brushed, and their garters of an indifferent knit. Let them curtsy with their left legs, and not presume to touch a hair of my master's horse tail till they kiss their hands. Are they all ready?
They are.
Call them forth.
Hear, hear, ho! You must meet my master to countenance my mistress.
Why, she hath a face of her own.
Well, who knows not that?
Thou, it seems, that calls for company to countenance her.
I call them forth to credit her.
Why, she comes to borrow nothing of them.
Welcome home, Grumio. Welcome, lad.
Welcome you, how now you, what you, fellow you, and thus much for greeting. Now, my spruce companions, is all ready and all things neat.
All things is ready. How near is our master?
In at hand, alighted by this, and therefore be... Hawks, passions, runs, I hear my master.
Where be these knaves? What? No man at door to hold my stirrup, nor to take my horse? Where's Nathaniel Greely Phillip?
Here, sir.
You loggerheaded and unpolished grooms. What? No attendance, no regard, no duty? Where's the foolish knave I sent before?
Here, sir, as foolish as I was before.
You peasant swain, you horse and malthorse drudge, did I not bid thee meet me in the park and bring along these rascal knaves with thee?
Nathaniel's coat, sir, was not fully made, and Gabriel's pumps were all unpinked at the heel. There was no link to colour Peter's hat, and Walter's dagger was not come from sheathing. There was none fine but Adam, Ralph, and Gregory. The rest were ragged, old, and beggarly. Yet, as they are come to meet you.
Go, rascals, go and fetch my supper in.
Oh...
Where is the life that late I led? Where are those... Sit down, Kate. Sit down and welcome.
Food, 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 food! Why, what I say?
Oh.
Nay, good sweet Kate, be merry. Oh. Off with my boots, you rogues. You villains, when?
Yes.
It was the Friar of Orders, gray as he for thou! Ah! You rogue, you pluck my foot awry. Take that! Ah! And mend the plucking of the other.
Yes, sir.
Be merry, Kate. Some water, hope. What, hope?
Sir?
Where's my spaniel, Troilus? Sirrah, get you hence and bid my cousin Ferdinand come hither, one Kate that you must kiss and be acquainted with.
Yes, sir.
Where are my slippers? Shall I have some water?
Master.
Come, Kate, and wash, and welcome heartily. You whoreson villain, will you let it fall?
Patience, I pray you. 'Twas a fault unwilling.
Whoreson beetle-headed, flap-eared knave. Come, Kate, sit down. I know you have a stomach. Will you give thanks, sweet Kate, or else shall I? What's this? Mutton.
I.
Who brought it?
I.
'Tis burnt. And so is all the meat. What dogs are these? Where is the rascal cook? How durst you villains bring it from the dresser and serve it thus to me, the lovely nut? There, take it to you. Trenchers, cups and all. Oh. You heedless jolt-heads and unmannered slaves. What? Do you grumble? I'll be with you straight.
I pray you, husband, be not so disquiet. The meat was well if you were so contented.
I tell thee, Kate, 'twas burnt and dried away. And I expressly am forbid to touch it, for it engenders choler, planteth anger. And better 'twere that both of us did fast, since of ourselves are choleric, than feed it with such over-roasted flesh. Be patient. Tomorrow it shall be mended, and for this night we'll fast for company. Come, I'll bring thee to thy bridal chamber.
Is he?
Mate, didst ever see the like?
He kills her in her own humour.
Where is he?
In her chamber, making a sermon of continency to her, and rails and swears and rates that she, poor soul, knows not which way to stand, to look, to speak, and sits as one new risen from a dream. Away, away, for he's coming hither.
Thus have I politically begun my reign, and 'tis my hope to end successfully. My falcon now is sharp and passing empty. Till she stoops, she must not be full gorged, for then she never looks upon her lure. Another way I have to man my haggard, to make her come and know her keeper's call, that is to watch her, as we watch these kites that bait and beat and will not be obedient. She ate no meat today, nor none shall eat. Last night she slept not, nor tonight she shall not. As with the meat, some undeserved fault I'll find about the making of the bed. And here I'll fling the pillow, there the bolster, this way the coverlet, another way the sheets. Aye, and amid this hurley, I'll intend that all is done in reverent care of her. And in conclusion, she shall watch all night. And if she chance to nod, I'll rail and brawl, and with the clamour keep her still awake. This is a way to kill a wife with kindness. And thus I'll curb her mad and headstrong humour. He that knows better how to tame a shrew, now let him speak. 'Tis charity to show.
Is it possible, friend Licio, that Mr. Spianca doth fancy any other but Lucentio? I tell you, sir, she bears me fair in hand.
Sir, to satisfy you in what I have said, stand by and mark the manner of his teaching.
Now, mistress, profit you in what you read?
What master read you? First resolve me that.
I read that I profess the art to love.
And may you prove, sir, master of your art.
While you, sweet dear, prove mistress of my heart.
Proceed as married now. Tell me, I pray you, that durst swear that your mistress Bianca loved none in the world so well as Lucentio.
Oh, despiteful love! Unconstant womankind! I tell thee, Licio, this is wonderful.
Mistake no more. I am not Licio, nor a musician as I seem to be, but one that scorns to live in this disguise for such a one as leaves a gentleman and makes a god of such a cullion. Know, sir, that I am called Hortensio.
Signor Hortensio? I have often heard of your entire affection to Bianca. And since mine eyes are witness of her lightness, I will with you, if you be so contented, forswear Bianca and her love forever.
Faith, mistress, I...
See how they kiss and court.
Oh.
Signor Lucentio, here is my hand, and here I firmly vow never to woo her more, but do forswear her, as one unworthy all the former favors that I have fondly flattered her withal.
And here I take the like unfeigned oath, never to marry with her, though she would entreat. Oh, fie on her! See how beastly she doth court him.
Would all the world but he had quite forsworn. For me, that I may surely keep mine oath, I will be married to a wealthy widow ere 3 days pass, which hath as long loved me as I have loved this proud, disdainful haggard. And so farewell, Signor Lucentio. Kindness in women, not their beauteous looks, shall win my love, and so I take my leave in resolution as I swore before.
Mistress Bianca, bless you with such grace as longeth to a lover's blessed case. Oh. Nay, I have ta'en you napping, gentle love, and have forsworn you with Hortensio.
Oh, Tranio, you jest. But have you both forsworn me?
Mistress, we have.
Then we are rid of Licio.
If faith, you have a lusty widow now that shall be wooed and wedded in a day.
God give him joy.
Aye, and he'll tame her.
He says so, Tranio.
Faith, he's gone unto the taming school.
The taming school? What is there such a place?
Oh, aye, mistress, and Petruchio is the master that teaches tricks 11 and 20 long to tame a shrew and charm her chattering tongue.
Oh, master, I've watched so long that I'm dog-weary, but at last I spied an ancient angel coming down the hill will serve the turn.
What is he, Biondello?
Master, a mercantant or a pedant, I know not what, but formal in apparel, in gait and countenance, surely like a father.
And what of him, Tranio?
If he be credulous and trust my tale, I'll make him glad to see Vincentio and give assurance to Baptista Minola as if he were the right Vincentio. Take in your love and then let me alone.
God save you, sir.
And you, sir. You are welcome. Travel you far on, or are you at the farthest?
Sir, at the farthest for a week or two, but then up farther, and as far as Rome, and so to Tripoli, if God lend me life.
What countryman, I pray?
Of Mantua.
Of Mantua? Sir, marry, God forbid! And come to Padua, careless of your life?
My life, sir? How I pray, for that goes hard.
'Tis death for anyone in Mantua to come to Padua. Oh. Know you not the cause? Your ships are stayed in Venice, and the Duke, for private quarrel twixt your Duke and him, hath published and proclaimed it openly. 'Tis marvel, but that you were but newly come, you might have heard it else proclaimed about.
Alas, sir, it is worse for me than so, for I have bills for money by exchange from Florence, and must here deliver them.
Well, sir, to do you courtesy, this will I do, and this I will advise you. First, tell me, have you ever been at Pisa?
Aye, sir, in Pisa have I often been. Pisa, renowned for grave citizens.
Among them, know you one Vincentio?
Oh, I know him not, but I have heard of him. A merchant of incomparable wealth.
Well, he is my father, sir, and sooth to say, in countenance somewhat doth resemble you.
As much as an apple doth an oyster in all words.
To save your life in this extremity, this favour will I do you for his sake. And think it not the worst of all your fortunes that you were like to serve Vincentio. His name and credit shall you undertake, and in my house you shall be friendly lodged. Look that you take upon you as you should. You understand me, sir? Oh, so shall you stay till you have done your business in the city.
Nay,
if this be courtesy, sir, accept of it.
Oh, sir, I do, and will repute you ever the patron of my life and liberty.
Then go with me to make the matter good. This, by the way, I let you understand, my father is here looked for every day to pass assurance of a dower in marriage twixt me and one Baptista's daughter here. In all these circumstances, I'll instruct you. Go with me to clothe you as becomes you.
Forsooth, I dare not for my life.
The more my wrong, the more his spite appears. What, did he marry me to famish me? Beggars that come unto my father's door upon entreaty have a present arms, if not elsewhere they meet with charity. But I, who never knew how to entreat, nor never needed that I should entreat, am starved for meat, giddy for lack of sleep, with oaths kept waking and with brawling fed. And that which spites me more than all these wants, he does it under name of perfect love. as who should say if I should sleep or eat to a deadly sickness or else present death. I prithee go and get me some repast. I care not what, so it be wholesome food.
What say you to a neat's foot?
'Tis passing good. I prithee let me have it.
Fear 'tis too choleric a meat. How say you to a fat tripe finely broiled?
I like it well, good Grumio, fetch it me.
I cannot tell, I fear 'tis choleric. Oh. What say you to a piece of beef and mustard?
A dish that I do love to feed upon.
Aye, but the mustard is too hot a little.
Why then the beef and let the mustard rest?
Nay, then I will not. You shall have the mustard or else you get no beef or Grumio.
Then both or one or anything thou wilt.
Why then the mustard without the beef.
Go, get thee gone, thou false-deluding slave that feeds me with the very name of meat. Sorrow on thee and all the pack of you that triumphs upon my misery. Go, get thee gone, I say.
How fares my case?
No.
What, sweeting, all amort?
Mistress, what cheer?
Faith as cold as can be.
Pluck up thy spirits. Look cheerfully upon me. Here, love, thou seest how diligent I am to dress thy meat myself and bring it thee.
Oh.
I am sure, sweet Kate, such kindness merits thanks. What, not a word? Nay, then, thou lovest it not, and all my pains is sorted to no proof. Here, take away the dish.
I pray you let it stand.
The poorest service is repaid with thanks, and so shall mine before you touch the meat.
I thank you, sir.
Signor Petruchio, fie, you are to blame. Come, Mistress Kate, I'll bear you company.
Eat it up all, Hortensio, if thou lovest me. Much good do it unto thy gentle heart. Kate, eat apace. And now, my honey love, will we return unto thy father's house and revel it as bravely as the best, with silken coats and caps and golden rings, with ruffs and cuffs and farthingales and things, with scarves and fans and double change of bravery, with amber bracelets, beads, and all this knavery. What? Hast thou dined?
Oh.
The tailor stays thy leisure to deck thy body with his ruffling treasure. Come, tailor, let's see these ornaments. Lay forth the gown. What news with you, sir?
Here is the cap, your worship, to bespeak.
Why, this was molded on a porringer, a velvet dish. Fie, tis lewd and filthy, white as a cockle, a walnut shell, a knack, a toy, a trick, a baby's cap, away with it. Come, let me have a bigger.
I'll have no bigger. This doth fit the time, and gentlewomen wear such caps as these.
When you are gentle, you shall have one too, and not till then.
That will not be in haste.
Why, sir, I trust I may have leave to speak. And speak I will. I am no child, no babe. Your betters have endured me say my mind, and if you cannot, best you stop your ears. My tongue will tell the anger of my heart, or else my heart concealing it will break. And rather than it shall, I will be free, even to the uttermost, as I please, in words.
Why, thou sayest true, it is a paltry cap. A custard coffin, a bauble, a silken pie. I love thee well, in that thou likest it not.
Love me or love me not, I like the cap. And it I will have or I will have none.
Thy gown? Why, aye, come, tailor, let's see it. Oh, mercy God, what masking stuff is here. What's this? A sleeve? 'Tis like a demi-cannon. What, up and down, carved like an apple tart? Here, snip and nip, a cut, slits and slash. Like to a censor in a barber shop. What the devil's name, tailor, calls thou this?
I see she'd like to have neither cap nor gown.
You bid me make it orderly and well, according to the fashion and the time.
Marian did, but if you be remembered, I did not bid you mar it to the time. Go, hop me over every kennel home, for you shall hop without my custom, sir. I'll none of it, hence make your best of it.
I never saw a better fashioned gown. More quaint, more pleasing, nor more commendable. Belike you mean to make a puppet of me.
Why, true! He means to make a puppet of thee.
She says your worship means to make a puppet of her.
Oh, monstrous arrogance. Oh. Thou liest, thou thread, thou thimble, thou yard, three quarters, half yard, quarter, nail, thou flea, thou knit, thou winter cricket, thou braved in mine own house with a skein of thread. Away, thou rag, thou quantity, thou remnant, or I shall so bemeet thee with thy yard as thou shalt think on prating whilst thou livest. I tell thee, aye, that thou hast marred her gown.
Your worship is deceived. The gown is made just as my master had direction. Grumio gave order how it should be done.
I gave him no order, I gave him the stuff.
But how did you desire it should be made?
Marry, sir, with needle and thread.
Oh, but did you not request to have it cut?
Thou hast faced many things.
I have.
Face not me.
Hm.
Thou hast braved many men. Brave not me.
Oh.
I will neither be faced nor braved. I say unto thee, I bid thy master cut out the gown, but I did not bid him cut it to pieces. Ergo thou liest.
Why, here is the note of the fashion to testify.
Really?
read it.
The note lies in the throat if you say I said so.
Imprimis, a loose bodied gown.
Master, if ever I said loose bodied gown, sew me in the skirts of it and beat me to death at the bottom of brown thread. I said a gown.
Proceed.
With a small compassed cape.
I confess the cape.
With a trunk sleeve.
I confess two sleeves.
The sleeves curiously cut.
Aye, there's the
error of the bill, sir. Error of the bill. I command that the sleeves should be cut out and sewed up again. And that I'll prove upon thee, though thy little finger be armed in a thimble.
This is true that I say. Oh, when I had thee in place where thou shouldst know it.
I am for thee straight. Oh. Take thou the bill, give me the meat yard, and spare not me.
But a mercy, Grumio, then it shall have no odds.
Well, sir, in brief, the gown is not for me.
You are the right, sir. It is for my mistress.
Go take it up unto thy master's use.
Villain, not for thy life. Take up my mistress' gown for thy master's use.
Why, sir, what's your conceit in that?
Oh, sir, the conceit is deeper than you think for. Take up my mistress' gown to his master's use. Oh, fie, fie, fie.
Hortensio, say thou will see the tailor paid. Go, take it, hands, be gone, and say no more.
I'll pay thee for thy gown tomorrow. Take no unkindness of his hasty words away, I say. Commend me to thy master.
Well, come, my Kate. We will unto your father's, even in these honest, mean habiliments. Our purses shall be proud, our garments poor. For 'tis the mind that makes the body rich. And as the sun breaks through the darkest clouds, so honor peereth in the meanest habit. What, is the jay more precious than the lark because his feathers are more beautiful? Or is the adder better than the eel because his painted skin contents the eye? Oh, no, good Kate. Neither art thou the worse for this poor furniture and mean array. If thou accounts it shame, lay it on me, and therefore frolic! We will henceforth with to feast and sport us at thy father's house. Go, call my men, and let us straight to him, and bring our horses unto Long Lane End. There will we mount, and thither walk on foot. Let's see, I think 'tis now some 7 o'clock, and well, we may come there by dinner time.
I dare assure you, sir, 'tis almost 2, and 'twill be supper time ere you come
it
there.
It shall be 7 ere I go to horse. Look what I speak or do or think to do. You are still crossing it. Sirs, let's alone. I will not go today.
Oh.
And ere I do, it shall be what o'clock I say it is.
Why, so this gallant will command the sun.
Sir, this is the house. Please it you that I call?
Aye, what else? But I be deceived. Senior Baptist may remember me near 20 years ago in Genoa, where we were lodgers at the Pegasus.
'Tis well, and hold your own in any case with such austerity as longeth to a father.
I warrant you. But, sir, here comes your boy. 'Twere good he was schooled.
Fear you not him. Sir Biondello?
Sir?
Now, do your duty thoroughly, I advise you. Imagine 'twere the right Vincentio.
Tat, fear not me.
But hast thou done thy errand to Baptista?
I told him that your father was at Venice, and that you looked for him this day in Padua.
Thou art a tall fellow. Hold thee that to drink.
Ah.
Here comes Baptista. Set your countenance, sir.
Good morrow, sir. Good morrow.
Signor Baptista, you are happily met.
Ah.
Sir, this is the gentleman I told you of. I pray you stand good father to me now. Give me Bianca for my patrimony.
Soft, son. Sir, by your leave, having come to Padua to gather in some debts, my son, Lucentio, made me acquainted with a weighty cause of love between your daughter and himself. And for the good report I hear of you, and for the love he beareth to your daughter, and she to him, to stay him not too long, I am content in a good father's care to have him matched. And if you please to like no worse than I, upon some agreement me shall you find ready and willing with one consent to have her so bestowed. For curious I cannot be with you, Signor Baptista, of whom I hear so well.
Oh, sir, pardon me in what I have to say. Your plainness and your shortness please me well. Right, true it is, your son Lucentio here doth love my daughter, and she loveth him, or both dissemble deeply their affections. And therefore, if you say no more than this, that like a father you will deal with him, and pass my daughter a sufficient dower, the match is made, and all is done. Your son shall have my daughter with consent.
I thank you, sir. Where then do you know best we be affied, and such assurance ta'en as shall with either part's agreement stand?
Not in my house, Lucentio. You know, pitchers have ears, and I have many servants. Besides, old Gremio is heartening still, and happily we might be interrupted.
Then at my lodging in it, like you, there doth my father lie, and there this night we'll pass the business privately and well. Send for your daughter by your servant here. My boy shall fetch the scrivener presently.
The worst is this, that at so slender warning, you are like to have a thin and slender pittance.
It likes me well. Cambio, hie you home and bid Bianca make her ready straight. And if you will tell what hath happened, Lucentio's father is arrived in Padua, and how she's like to be Lucentio's wife.
I pray the gods she may, with all my heart.
Dally not with the gods, but get thee gone.
Signor Baptista, shall I lead the way? Welcome. One mess is like to be your cheer. Come, sir, we will better it in Pisa.
I follow you.
Cambio.
What sayst thou, Biondello?
You saw my master wink and laugh upon you?
Biondello, what of that?
Oh, faith, nothing, but he has left me here behind to expound the meaning or moral of his signs and tokens.
I pray thee, moralize them.
Then thus, Baptista is safe talking with the deceiving father of a deceitful son.
And what of him?
His daughter is to be brought by you to the supper.
And then?
The old priest at St. Luke's Church is at your command at all hours.
What of all this?
I cannot tell, except while they are busied about a counterfeit assurance, take you assurance of her. Come privilegio et imprimenda. Solum. To the church, take the priest clerk and some sufficient honest witnesses.
But Biondello,
if this be not what you look for, I've no more to say. But bid Bianca farewell forever and a day.
Here is thou, Biondello.
I cannot tarry. I knew a wench married in an afternoon as she went to the garden for parsley to stuff a rabbit. And so may you, sir. And so had you, sir. My master hath appointed me to go to St. Luke's to bid the priest be ready to come against you. Come with your appendix.
I may and will if she be so contented. She will be pleased, then wherefore should I doubt? Hap what hap may, I'll roundly go about her. It shall go hard if Cambio go without her.
Come on, a God's name, once more toward our fathers.
Good Lord, how bright and goodly shines the moon.
The moon? The sun. It is not moonlight now.
I say it is the moon that shines so bright.
I know it is the sun that shines so bright.
Now, by my mother's sun, and that's myself, it shall be moon, or star, or what I list, or ere I journey to your father's house. Go on, fetch our horses back again. Oh. Evermore crossed and crossed, nothing but crossed.
Say as he says, or we shall never go.
Forward, I pray, since we have come so far. And be it moon, or sun, or what you please. And if you please to call it a rush candle, henceforth I vow it shall be so for me.
I say it is the moon.
I know it is the moon.
Nay, then you lie. It is the blessed sun.
Then God be blessed. It is the blessed sun. But sun it is not when you say it is not. And the moon changes even as your mind. What you will have it named, even that it is. And so it shall be so for Catherine.
Petruchio, go thy ways. The field is won.
Well, forward, forward. Thus the bowl should run. And not unluckily against the bias. But, sir, what company is coming here?
Good morrow, sir.
Good morrow, gentle mistress. Where away?
What?
Tell me, sweet Kate, and tell me truly, too. Hast thou beheld a fresher gentlewoman?
Huh?
Such ward of white and red within her cheeks. What stars do spangle heaven with such beauty as those two eyes become that heavenly face? Fair, lovely maid, once more, good day to thee. Sweet Kate, embrace her for her beauty's sake.
I will make the man mad to make a woman of him.
Young, budding... virgin, fair and fresh and sweet, whither away or whither is thy abode? Happy the parents of so fair a child.
Where'd I...
Happier the man whom favorable stars allot thee for his lovely bedfellow.
Why, now, Kate, I hope thou art not mad. This is a man. Old, wrinkled, faded, withered, and not a maiden, as thou sayst he is.
Pardon, old father. My mistaking eyes that have been so bedazzled with the sun... that everything I look on seemeth green. Now I perceive thou art a reverend father. Pardon, I pray thee, for my mad mistaking.
Do good, old grandsire, and withal make known which way thou travellest. If along with us, we shall be joyful of thy company.
Fair sir, and you, my merry mistress, that with your strange encounter much amazed me. My name is called Vincentio, my dwelling Pisa. And bound I am to Padua there to visit a son of mine, which long I have not seen.
What is his name?
Lucentio, gentle sir.
Happily met! The happier for thy son. And now by law, as well as reverend age, I may entitle thee my loving father. The sister to my wife, this gentlewoman, thy son by this hath married.
Oh.
Now, wonder not, nor be not grieved. She is of good esteem, her dowry wealthy and of worthy birth. Beside, so qualified as may beseem the spouse of any noble gentleman.
Let me embrace with old Vincentio. And wonder we to see thy honest son, who will of thy arrival be full joyous.
But is this true? Or is it else your pleasure, like pleasant travellers, to break a jest upon the company you overtake?
I do assure thee, father, so it is.
Come, go along and see the truth hereof, for our first merriment hath made thee jealous.
Well, Petruchio, this has put me in heart. Have to my widow, and if she be froward, then hast thou taught Hortensio to be untoward.